wasn't really quite sure where to put our next speaker. Didn't really fit into any of the sessions, so I said, why don't you just come and give a talk. Austin Hines is the CEO of Cambrian Genomics, and they've figured out a way to print DNA at orders of magnitude less cost than previously. So everyone's familiar with how sequencing, the cost of sequencing has come down, but also the cost of actually printing DNA or creating the DNA is coming down as well. And he's going to talk about how to create your own creatures by printing DNA in our Demo Labs series. Austin.
Welcome, Cambrian Genomics.
Cool. So I have 10 minutes. So welcome, everybody. It's great to be here in beautiful, exotic San Jose. We'll see if these slides work. So these are the electrode arrays that we make our DNAs on. We are now transitioning to hardware, so I'm not going to show you any graphs and metrics, just pieces of bits and physical, bits and atoms instead of bits and physical items. So this is the electrode array that we make our DNA on. After we make our DNA on these electrodes, we then sequence the DNA to see if it's good or bad. So we make DNA cheap in the way that transistors were made cheap. Transistors became super cheap because you could make the transistors massively parallel and you didn't have to fix them. We make DNA cheap by making the DNA massively parallel and sequencing it to see what's good and what's bad. We don't actually correct the DNA. We see what's good and what's bad from sequencing, and then we recover the good ones. So doesn't look like our video is going to show, but this is a sequencing chip. You use a razor blade to actually cut open the chip, and so you can access the sequences inside. The next step is you laser catapult the correct sequences on these beads here into a collection plate. From there, you use a bunch of robots to assemble the DNA into long pieces, and that's where the things actually start getting fun. That's where we can start making creatures, making organisms. So many of you guys know about the MakerBot, where you can print a cool plastic item. You could even sell it if it's very interesting. Our idea is that if you've got a good idea about making a creature, maybe a consumer product, that you could, you know, design it on a computer, print it out, boot it up, and then make iterations on it to improve it. So this is how the process works. We work with an Israeli company called Genome Compiler to design the DNA. We then print the DNA, and then we transform it into a living organism. The organism grows up, and then it's a functional living thing. It's in the DNA code. So it's very scalable, because the creature will have babies, and you can sell the babies. In the case of plants that grow seeds, a single plant can produce seeds for hundreds or even thousands of customers. So this was our first creature that we did. It's a real creature. It's a plant. Originally, we did this in Arabidopsis, but we printed out the DNA from a firefly pathway, the luciferase-luciferin pathway. And after the DNA was printed, we put it into the creature, in this case, the plant, into some stem cells, grew it up into the full plant. And when we turned the lights off, it glowed. So this is the result of the crowdfunding campaign. Did about $500,000 in 6 weeks. Since then, done over $1 million from over 10,000 different customers around the country at this point. The point of this was that we did this company for $10,000 to shoot a cool video, get people excited about it. In reality, we actually had no idea whether we could make a glowing plant or whether anything would actually work, but we knew we could make a video for it. And then after we got the money, the company could use the money to hire people, could hire employees. And similar to why startups in the software space are cheap, you're basically only paying for employees. The computers are so cheap these days, you don't really figure that into the cost. So we're making DNA for these guys for free, so they don't have to pay for DNA. They're also getting shared use lab space. so they can get access to lots of expensive hardware and not have to pay for it. So their only cost is their employee overhead. So being able to do a company now with a $10,000 investment, getting them to $1 million plus revenue in a few weeks, and then letting them build out a team, and then get to product prior to them actually going out and raising money from venture capitalists. So that's super exciting. Like they can go and actually have a product ready and real customers before they raise money. That means they can raise money on similar terms to software companies, which is good because that means employees and founders of these companies can maintain control of their companies, which I think is necessary to have a robust ecosystem where you have excited entrepreneurs that want to build these companies. So it received a lot of tech press, and it now works. And so we have giant grow houses in my lab, a couple of them, filled with these plants. We're doing our first shipments in December of these plants that glow in the dark. So glow in the dark plant, that sounds like a trivial thing. Why would you pick a plant? It's kind of boring. It's a simple, it's a fun project. And if you can engineer a plant to glow in the dark, imagine what else you can make a plant do. Make a plant suck all the carbon out of the atmosphere. You can make a plant produce foods that feed the world. With the cost of DNA being cheap enough, really anyone with a mobile phone and an internet connection and a credit card or some Bitcoin can make a cool creature, make a cool company. What we aim to do as a company is to go from maybe 100,000 to 200,000 GMO creators in the entire world to billions of developers. Literally every kid that goes through school, you know, I think I was back of the generation where we got one of these Macs loaded with Oregon Trail, and we all became, you know, digital natives because we all grew up with these computers. And now this next generation is growing to grow up biology native, where they know that they can read and write the code of life for all the things that live on this planet. And eventually, as a company, our goal is to take everything that's existing and natural and replace it with a synthetic version. So by writing the DNA, we can do much better than nature. We can make better humans, we can make better plants, we can make better animals, we can make better bacteria. So let's talk about what's coming next. So these are the campaigns I don't think really anyone's heard about yet, probably in this audience. These are very new. These are launching on our own platform, our crowdfunding platform called Creature Creator. So the first one is Petomics. We're actually making your poop smell like bananas using genetic pathways. Also, we do mint. So this is the demo conference. So actually, I'm going to have our entrepreneur. We have an Israeli entrepreneur named Gilad Gomi who's going to come on the stage in a minute or so and actually give you guys a demo. You can eat it if you want, but it's still beta, so watch out. What's cool about this is that we can program it and write circuits in there so that we can potentially also use it as a sensor. So when your farts change from wintergreen to banana, maybe that means that you have an infection in your gut, gastric colitis or some kind of disease like that. Sweet peach, which is a similar idea. The idea is to get rid of UTIs and yeast infections and change the smell of the vagina through probiotics. So not only can you sequence your gut microbes and your vaginal microbes and the microbes that grow on your head and under your arms, but you can actually program them, you can write them, you can change them, and you can make them personal to you. You can control all the code that lives on you, which is exciting because previously the natural world has been beyond our grasp. We've recently, within the last 10 years, been able to read it. Now we finally have the cost low enough that anyone can write it on their phones. So the idea is your microbes can be out of balance. Sweet peach will balance them, improve smell, and everybody's happy. Babies, so we're interested in genetically modifying humans through the sequencing of sperm progenitor cells, egg progenitor cells, as well as embryos. We're starting with sequencing sperm to verify quality and storing it so that it doesn't mutate. And then we're moving on to pre-implantation genetic diagnosis, i.e. sequencing of embryos. The next step will be to edit those, either those embryos or edit the progenitor cells to sperm and egg so that we can genetically engineer the entire human population to not have disease, because nobody likes that. and everybody getting healthy and happy. And then, well, I guess that's it. The next project, I guess, will be secret. All right, Gilad, you want to come on stage and show people what you got?
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Austin. It's great to be here. So I'm here to talk to you about personalized probiotics and two of the projects you just saw. One of them is Potomix. The other one is Sweet Peach. And I'll just start by describing a little bit the landscape. Basically, I was educated in Singularity University to positively impact the lives of 1 billion people in 10 years. And to do that, I decided that I must positively impact the lives of 100 trillions of bacteria that are harboring on my body. And these bacteria actually are very dynamic, and we leave it up to chance for them to be a part of us. So this is the first organ or pseudo-organ that we can actually hack using the DNA from Cambrian genomics. We take the DNA, we figure out the metabolic pathways and the genetic elements that can move the DNA into these bacteria, and we make them do stuff. We add enzymes that create metabolites and create scents, like you saw, and flavors. And these scents and flavors and colors are reporter genes that can help us answer many questions that regard our health and even our cognitive capabilities. So I brought today just a small example to show you.
Why don't you show Matt? Yeah, have you smelled these yet?
So this is just a simple banana scent producing. You guys can pass it around. Just smell it.
So these are microbes that
have... Smells like banana?
Banana smelling pathways inside of them, so that when you eat these and you poop, you can smell like bananas instead of something else. Bad news is that people actually like the smell of their own farts and poop, but they don't really like their pets. And you definitely don't like it when you're driving on the 5 and it smells horrible. So definitely for those applications, I think you're going to want to buy this product. All right.
Let me ask a question here because we're running out of time. But my reaction is kind of to paraphrase Peter Thiel, who is going to be on stage later on today. We were promised designer jeans, but now all we got was a banana that smells like poop.
Correct. It's not about that.
Why is this significant?
All right.
Well, yeah, you probably wouldn't want that. You want the poop that smells like bananas.
That's a great question.
The other way,
that's a great question.
A better selling
mixed
product.
Up
that's
there.
A great question. Yeah. I think it's harder to hack into our own cells. We're better at hacking into bacterial cells.
Yeah.
So there's a huge advantage in the microbiome. That's why it's going to expand a lot more.
So, for Creature Creator, our first products are consumer. That get a lot of attention, that are easy to make and sell. So easy to make and sell plants, easy to make and sell bacteria. And our human applications are going to be a bit further. Our dinosaur applications maybe even a bit further than that.
The current companies that are working on probiceuticals, mm-hmm. as they're called, are actually combating regulation. And they're also having a lot of difficulties in creating a lot of interest from the public because it's so futuristic, if you will.
Yeah.
And you were when the first human genome was sequenced, you actually were promised designer genes and so on and so forth. But the fact of the matter is that today we're able to hack into bacteria and iterate.
And we're doing unregulated markets to begin with. So the plants are, we've gotten those through past, really haven't faced any regulation. These probiotic products are not regulated just because the FDA has been pushed away by the larger probiotics industry, which is fairly sizable. So we think it's a fundamental human right to not only know your code and the code of things that live on you, but also to write your own code and personalize your code. So In the short term, it's changing the way you smell. All your smells are non-human. They're produced by the creatures that live on you. So you can change that.
But that sounds, I think to a lot of people in this room, that sounds like you're playing God.
Well, no, everyone gets to play God, though. So it's like, it's equal.
We all get to be gods. Is that a good thing? Should everyone
when the first person,
should I be able to create all sorts of pathogens?
When the first person brought fire to his camp,
yeah.
People thought he was crazy. Mm-hmm. What are you doing bringing this crazy thing? We're going to burn it. But then he showed them that you can use this technology to make food and to disinfect stuff.
Yeah, the idea is personal empowerment. We don't want the state telling people like what they can grow on them. We don't want the state telling people like what kind of babies that they can have and what genes they can fiddle with. We want it to be, you know, self-directed. Now, there is security concerns that are very valid. This technology is probably more powerful than a hydrogen bomb, could kill everyone on the planet for sure. So you have to centralize the technology and virtualize the service.
And you're asking us to trust you?
Sure, why not?
So, Matt, are you an investor in Cambridge?
I'm not only an investor in Cambridge, I'm an investor in the tool chain that they're using. And we're an investor in a bunch of other very deep computational synthetic biology companies.
Why did you invest in this, if I may ask?
Well, to Austin's point, it's coming, and you can either let crazed, medievally minded terrorists who often have PhDs, doesn't mean they're dumb, be the ones who are up the curve on it, or repressive governments, or other people with an agenda, or you can try to figure out a safe, sane way for this power to be distributed. It's coming, it's irrevocable, and so we decided we'd rather be on the side of the angels than on the side of the devils.
Okay, then final thing, so you're launching,
The Creature Creator platform, which is Kickstarter for creatures. So we got banned from Kickstarter after the Galling Plant. They gave us our money, but they said, don't come back because we're a bunch of hipsters from New York and we like making movies and videos. We don't like supporting actual cool science. So we have Creature Creator, which is launching on tilt.com, and our Panomics project, as well as our Sweet Peach project and product will be launching on that platform. Creaturecreator.co. If you have anyone in the audience wants to do a company, email me at Austin, A-U-S-T-E-N, at creaturecreator.co about your idea. We have about a 2,000 square foot shared use lab space for you to make your creature, and we can help you get off the ground in terms of shooting a video that you can use to raise hundreds of thousands of dollars very quickly.
All right, and I hope that one day we'll have some of those companies launching here on stage demo. Thank you very much.
This is our first. All right, thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.